with the lifting industry being as critical as it is, with, you know, there's times lifts, you know, can mean life and death of the people making the lifts. You know, an accident could cause harm or death to an individual. It's always good to, you know, to take something like this and take it to the companies that deal with this on a day in, day out basis. You know, let the professionals who do live in this industry every day kind of do that.
Lifting and rigging is a serious business. Creating an OSHA-compliant below-the-hook lifting device takes expertise in the ASME standards as well as the appropriate insurance to back that device. When looking for a custom below-the-hook device, you need to go to a company that not only can build a device for your needs, but can meet every single one of OSHA's requirements for that device. In this video, we'll explain our process here at Mazzella for engineering and manufacturing a custom below-the-hook device, from identifying a need, to lead time, to delivery, so you know what you can expect when purchasing a device from a third party. My name is Ben, and this is the Lifting and Rigging Channel. So, maybe your crane isn't performing as efficiently or as safely as you think it can. Maybe it takes too long to secure a load or remove your load using slings. Or maybe something just doesn't seem right about the way the load is balanced or moves once it's up in the air. So, you're thinking about getting a custom engineered below the hook device. Well, today we sit down with Dan Sherwood, below the hook product manager, so we can create some expectations around the process of ordering a custom below-the-hook device. So, let's get into it.
So there's two standards that below-the-hook lifting devices have to follow when being designed. The first one being the ASME B3020, the second one being the ASME BTH-1. Now the B3020 really handles talking about the tagging requirements, load testing, that type of information, whereas the BTH-1 kind of digs deeper and talks more on the engineering side with safety factors, design categories, service classes. It kind of gets into the nitty-gritty details of what this lifter needs to meet, you know, from the engineering side, whereas the B3020 kind of talks about what needs to be on each lifter for it to be considered, you know, compliant. Mazzella has years of that expertise of understanding the knowledge. We have engineers that actually sit on the committees that write the standards that we have to follow. We have, you know, all the appropriate insurances and everything to be able to provide you with a device that is certified, that is, you know, backed by, you know, professional engineers, backed by, you know, the standards. It will meet every OSHA requirement to a lifting device. You know, when the customer calls us or, you know, our sales reps on site and they identify an application that the customer is in need of a below the hook device, most of the time we're going to send out a product specialist focused in below the hook to go out, review the application with the customer, go over everything with the customer, make sure we have a full understanding of what they're trying to achieve in this lift, you know, understand the parameters of it, gather, you know, some of the measurements of what it is they're lifting, you know, restrictions around what they may be lifting, get all that information together in a front load and bring it back to our engineering team. Our engineering team is gonna work with our estimation team to kind of put together a rough idea of what it is that we're gonna provide them for our estimation team to be able to provide the quote to the customer. Once the quote's provided to the customer and the customer is okay with it and we receive a purchase order from them, it'll then go on into full on engineering. So engineering will take that, start putting together what we call as our approval drawings. So our approval drawings will be the drawing of what it is we're going to provide, and we'll have critical dimensions and measurements on there, you know, that we ask the customer or, you know, the product specialist and the customer to go back out, go over the whole process, the application of how they're trying to lift it, you know, make sure all the measurements and what it is that we have come up with, we feel is going to work in the application and be the best piece for the application. You know, once all that is agreed upon, we'll get the customer to sign off on the approval drawings. That then kicks it over into kind of the manufacturing process side. engineering will go through, finish off their build prints. We'll get the materials in, we'll fabricate it. You know, if we are load testing it, we'll load test it, paint it, and then ship it off to the customer for the customer to go ahead and start using it. Lead time can vary depending on the complexity of the part. You know, if it's what we kind of call falling more in our standard product offerings, you know, where there's not, it's not a big, huge, complex build that's gonna require, you know, machining and a lot of secondary processes to it. You know, we're typically anywhere between 6 to 10 weeks on a build like that. If we're starting to get into some of the bigger items, some of the mill duty items, some of the stuff that, you know, has to get fabricated, go out for machining, you know, have these secondary processes done to it, we can be, you know, again, depending on it, anywhere from 10 weeks to, you know, 24 weeks on something like that. If you get a device from Mazzella's and for whatever reason, you know, damage happens to the device, we immediately want you to contact your Mazzella representative. We'll pull that device out of your facility and we'll start an investigation into, you know, what happened so we can have a full understanding of what might have caused the failure on the device. You know, if it was, you know, misuse, you know, mismanufacturing, you know, just a you know, misunderstanding of the application and there were forces applied that, you know, were not considered into it. We'll take all that into account. If it, you know, it was just something that, you know, we've had this device for years and, you know, something finally kind of broke on it, you know, from just life of it, you know, we'll take that, bring it in, inspect the entire lifter, repair it and get it back to you to get back into the field to use. We do not recommend that you work on or repair any of our equipment in the field. You know, in doing so, it could void the manufacturer's warranty and, you know, liabilities of that device. When an accident happens, if it's a recordable, it's going to bring OSHA in. If you've ever had dealings with OSHA inspectors, you'll understand that they really kind of dig into everything to make sure that it's up to standard, meets the standard requirements. So, you know, from our experiences, when OSHA inspectors go in and they find devices that, you know, do not have all the proper markings of the B3020, you know, they start to question it and start probing the customers, asking for, you know, some of the backup information on it. And when customers don't have that, that's when they start to find, you know, some of the fines and everything coming in place. And, you know, on top of the fines that OSHA will imply, you know, they stand the chance for some type of legal ramification from, you know, either the individual that was injured or if it was, you know, a contractor from a different company, the company could be coming after them. Even as far down as to like if an in-house engineer, you know, did some drawings for it, put something together to have it manufactured, that engineer could find themselves personally in a situation where they could be getting, you know, sued or have legal ramifications brought upon them. You know, it'll just put everybody in kind of a tough spot that they didn't need to be in, you know, because there are companies out there who offer, you know, lifting solutions that are company certified to meet all of the standards, all of the requirements, and be designed to do what they're designed to do. So when you purchase a engineered lifting device, it's going to come with all the appropriate tagging on it that meets the B3020. It's going to have all the engineering behind it that meets the ASME BTH-1. There's a really good chance it will have been load tested as long as, you know, the company making it has the capacities to load test and what the device is. But the device is gonna come in, it's gonna have all the appropriate warning markings on it, it's gonna have all the appropriate tagging on it. You know, it's going to be designed specifically to do the application that it's intended to do.
If you're ready to purchase a custom below the hook device from a third party, then we have a great checklist that you and your team can go through to help speed up the process. The link is in the description below. It covers 19 points your team should know and consider before requesting a design. Once you go through the checklist, you can use the design sheet page to really dive into the details of what you need. If you need more information, we have some great resources linked below. And MazzellaCompanies.com has great articles, videos, podcasts, and downloads to help with your below-the-hook solutions. I hope this video helped clear up the process of getting a custom below-the-hook device engineered and manufactured for your needs. If you found this video useful, informative, entertaining, or you just feel like being friendly, then hit that like button so we can get this information out to everyone who needs it. Subscribe and hit the bell so you never miss a video. If you have a question, drop it in the comments so we can get you an answer. My name is Ben, and I'll see you in the next one.